Hey, yo, it's me, the Drosty. Hello, everybody. How's it going? How are you doing today or tonight? Gotta do 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 do. Out of sight. Let me go start a Planescape Torment Edition, Enhanced Edition. Though it makes me wonder if this is the Enhanced Edition, what does the Dehanced Edition look like? You know? I imagine not too good, not too beautiful. Look, there I am. Okay. I'd like to select my life. Civic Fest Hall. Don't mind if I do. Alrighty. So we're back here. Hey, get that classical music going. Done. Last time we were here, we touched a statue and then he said, hey, please stop. Now we have to look around for someone who might be able to help us understand further who we are. Warrior in training. Quite a bit. Is there someone here that's not a warrior in training? How about you, Tiefling? This person is practicing various combat maneuvers on a wooden training dummy. They seem far too busy to speak with you at the moment. Okay, we'll try over here. Hello, Geisus the Crooked. This squat, hunched old man still has the broad shoulders and scarred, calloused hands of a worker or a warrior. An aura of weary despair seems to hang about him. He appears to be giving a lecture at the moment. Hello.
Right, now listen up. This is the seminar on the war. If you're here to listen about blood war, take root. If you're not in the wrong all, you'd best up your soft, comfort-loving, signaling the limber stems out of here.
The blood war? More boring than listening to a governor recite laws. Let's find some young sensates who need to be indoctrinated in the ways of passion. He waggles eyebrows in anticipation. He doesn't have any, though. Alright, Morte, we'll go. Yeah, I don't want to listen to boring. Wartime? No thanks. Jumble Murder Sense. The short, balding man's orange tunic and rather sizable gut give him the look of a walking pumpkin. He is absent-mindedly patting his large paunch with a slow rhythm, as if it were a drum. The man's odd, crooked smile and a strange gleam in his eyes make him look a bit mad. Hello. The man gives an exaggerated, flourishing bow and presents a small card which reads only Jumble Murder Sense. Zizatek Zorcerer. Zytra Denair. He snatches the card from your grasp and proceeds to eat it, grinning wildly at the wall. All the while, sorry. Okay. Morte whispers, somewhere an asylum is one barm short. I had some questions, Jumble. Jumble yawns and looks away, drumming on his belly with the palms of his hands. Jumble, my questions? Jumble rolls his eyes, he turns to you, smirks, and bites his thumb. Are you mute? Is that what you want to answer me? Jumble cocks his head and gives you a stupid grin. Slowly he shrugs, then shuts his eyes and sticks his tongue out at you. Want some answers? Jumble raises an eyebrow and takes a step back. He opens his mouth abruptly, and though his lips or throat don't move to shape any words or sound, a torrent of incomprehensible babbling begins to pour forth.
Updated my journal.
Jumble shuts his mouth, and the babbling ceases. He peers at you through narrowed eyes, a self-satisfied smile on his pudgy face. Suddenly you hiccup, and hiccup, and hiccup again. Jumble Murdersense merely turns his head and waves you away. Uh-oh. Looks like you just got a curse thrown down on you, Chief. Jumble, please, son, do whatever you want. Jumble ignores you entirely. Pack him. He just tried to fuck it. He just cursed me. I'll kill you for this. God damn it. He fucking cursed me. No! I keep hiccuping. Stop. Stop! Thin and sharp-featured, his yellow skin covered with tattoos, this man looks over the room and its inhabitants with cold black eyes. He appears to be giving a lecture. Damn. I'll stay for the lecture. I am known as the Three Planes Aligned, a Githzari scholar. You are here for my lecture. It begins in a few moments. Morte says loudly. Come on, Chief. Are we really gonna stay for this? I wanna listen for now. He speaks in a low, somber tone. Today, I shall speak of the power of alignment and belief, and how they shape the planes. First, I shall explain the concept of alignment. Alignment is a descriptor of one's beliefs and how one acts upon those beliefs. At their core, all creatures predominantly behave in one of three ways, with the good in their heart, with evil in their heart, or indifference or neutrality in their heart. They predominantly express each of these core behaviors in one of three different ways, in an ordered manner, in a chaotic manner, or in an indifferent neutral manner. Thus, there are nine core alignments that one is capable of. Nine alignments, then, are lawful good, neutral good, and chaotic good. Lawful neutral, true neutral, and chaotic neutral. And lawful evil, neutral evil, and chaotic evil. Now I shall speak of the power of alignment and the beliefs in engenders of how from them the very deities gain strength and how belief can physically affect one's environments. Okay. Oh. Belief, I don't need it. I'm hiccuping anyways. Maybe I should just revert. It's a little distracting to have the hiccups and all that. This person is trying to remove items from the pockets of a stuffed mannequin, which is suspended from a frame and hung with various bells and chimes. Each time the person touches the mannequin too forcefully, it jingles loudly. Okay. I think we might actually have to go. What the fuck was that noise? Doesn't one of these assholes have like a curse relief or something? Where's the decursor? Please, I'm begging you. Oh boy. Okay. We gotta leave here for a bit. Just a little bit. Yeah, that's not gonna work. That full-heartedly will not be working out for me. Sorry. It's not like his hiccups are hurting him. Unless they are. In that case, we need to get to Ragpicker Square right away.
All right.
Uh-oh. Oh boy. Please, Old Macbeth. I need decursing, please. Oh, a cursed item. I don't need a cursed item removed. I need something that will I need something that will remove a curse. Don't you have that spell? Scroll of Remove Curse. Scroll of Remove Curse allows user to cast Remove Curse, allows user to copy Remove Curse into spellbook. Level 4 wizard. Range 0. Duration instant. Speed 4. Special nothing. Cursed item shall no longer afflict you when this spell is cast. When cast, the spell removes a curse upon the person targeted. It does not remove the curse from the actual item itself, but it allows the person to successfully unequip and rid themselves of the cursed item. Oh, that's actually pretty cool. So if I want to, like, make it... Okay, alright, I get it now. Let me go ahead and sell some of this stuff. I get it now. Basically, when I gave that ring to, I think it was Anna, and she became cursed to wear it forever, I can now remove it from her. So that way, she no longer is cursed. Copy this spell. Great. I would like to go to your mage spell book. Tongue of Flame. 80 feet. One creature. The flame scorches and burns. Its hatred arcs and swirls as it strikes the enemy without error. The spell summons a missile of flame that strikes its target unerringly for 2 to 5 points of magical fire damage with no saving throws possible. In addition, the caster gains one extra missile every 2 levels for a total of 5 missiles at level 9. Tongue of Flames. Oh, so yeah, I don't need... yeah. Remove it from my memory spells. Wait, where's the thing I just got for him? Oh! I didn't even need to remove that. Whoopsies. Yeah, re-add that. Thank you. Okay. Elemental Strike. Instant. Speed 4. Area of effect. One or more creature or object. Globes of elemental force fly forth and explode upon impact. Those within range are caught in its blast wave as well. Like magic missile, blah blah blah. Okay, so I have to... No, please, please! I gave him the curse! I gave him the curse, please! I'm begging you, you have to remove it. Thank you. Okay. Now, please sleep. Could I rest here? Thank you, that's fine. Okay, great. No, it's fine. Yes, Agnes. Uncurse me. There, I should be good. No! What?! I should be uncursed right now. Where's the fucking curse thing? It's just bullshit! Oh my god. Fucking... Ugh, I'm so close. Oh, it's too late. I already have to... Okay, well... At least we learned our lesson. Don't mess with him. I don't know. I'll wait until, you know, an actual person can help. Because apparently most of them are all like, yeah, whatever. You. Oh wait, that's Merryman. I don't think I've talked to you. This man looks like a bitter cantankerous old codger. His mouth is twisted into a frown that becomes even more severe as he notices you coming his way. Merryman, my name may be, but merry I am not. Off with you, young one. No time for the likes of you. He goes into a fit of coughing from the exertion of shooing you away so loudly. Okay. Crane scoop. Oh, zombie. Zombie McCrombie. I got cursed with hiccups. I tried to remove the curse, but it didn't work. And I accidentally reverted. Agent training. This person is staring intently at a metal panel mounted on the chamber's walls. For a moment of fierce concentration, they wave their hands about and utter a scream. Oh, one second, I'll be right back.
Okay, I return.
The cat was meowing.
Sorry about that. You stare intently. Goodbye. You'll have to take off the cursed item, aka your large-necked hobo shirt that Ace hates slash cursed. It was awful. All I did was ask for answers, and he said, find the source of Feyrod's bodies of Imoric. Nimel, Nestor's Fork, Watra, find the Night Hag, Ravel Puzzle Well. Oh, also, how's your little elliptical going? It's going pretty okay. Basically, we had to move a whole lot of stuff to get it in a nice place. And, yeah. I gave it a few tries. It felt a little off balance. So, now I'm gonna wait until, I get a little bit of extra money and buy, like, you know, a piece of paper. Or two, three times piece of paper. Put it under one of the sides. Oh, in-game you've been cursed? Well, I thought you meant in real life. Oh, no. I was cursed with hiccups in the in-game. Gillian's welcome. Please take your seat and listen to the darks of which I speak. Darks? Give me a break. We're not going to listen to this rattle trap, are we? Come on, let's go find some Senate chits that have never had the pleasurous sensation of tasting the fiery passion of a skull's lips. He waggles an eyebrow in anticipation. Well, listen for a bit. Come on, Morton. He begins to speak with a somber tone. Death is what awaits you at the end of life's journey. He coughs slightly, then raises his eyebrow dramatically, waving his hand at the same time. Death is not an end, but a beginning. Morte whispers, beginning of more suffering. Not to Morte quietly. For when you die, you shall not cease to exist. No, far from it. The outer plane shall become you in their breast, and you to their breast. There a new life, one such as you have never known, awaits you there. Morte whispers, that's for sure. Not to Morte. You shall cast away the tattered cloak of this life and become one of the faithful of Petitioner. As a Petitioner of the Outer Plane, your life's journey shall truly begin. If you have been a goodly sort of gentleman, steadfast in charity and goodwill toward your fellow bloods, perhaps the light-blanketed slopes of Mount Celestia shall house you when you die. Your spirit shall pass on to this place, dwelling as a Petitioner. The beauty of golden mornings, soft sunlight that caresses, says dreamily. Morte whispers, and an infernal boredom. Yeah, nod. Perhaps you lived your life to betray others and get ahead giving lies instead of truths, backstabbing others. All accomplish your own goals. Cold, blood-red carcery, the plane where all turncoats fall when they pass on, shall be the cage that imprisons you. As a Petitioner of this plane, you shall live a life of treachery. Whoa! Thanks for the follow, Wood! Wood, rain, mud. I like that. Thank you so much. When they pass on, shall be the cage. You shall live a life of treachery and treacheries. Treachery and treacheries. Of lies and lying. Knowing a life without trust. Morte whispers. Looks like we know where we both are going to end up when we die. Really? He hunches over, his eyes dart back and forth. And perhaps you have lived a life of bloodthirsty evil, contemptuous of your fellow man, laying others low and doing as you pleased without a care for what or what you hurt. Listening. It is perhaps one of the lower planes, Bator, or the chaotic swirling layers of the abyss that shall welcome you. Evil to the core are the spirits that come to this plane, and most are doomed to mindless cruelty and suffering or servitude in the dreaded, he whispers dramatically, blood war. Orte whispers, and that's if you're lucky. Shit. What's the negative of hiccups? He does it like every 5 seconds. And sometimes it makes him stop walking, and I imagine it would make him stop attacking. You know when you get a song stuck in your head and you can't remember the name of the artist, let alone the name of the song, so you get a terrible headache trying to rack your brain on it? Sometimes, but I usually try to remember the song and or album cover or, you know, a lyric. But I know what you mean. Oh, you're not a good the mountain of off limits to you. Yeah, basically. Mount Olympus? Say goodbye to that. A link. That's an accident. Don't click it.
It's a fucking shitty link.
No matter where you go, know this. You shall be embarking on a new life. A new life of my Sigillians. Morte whispers.
That's supposed to be an incentive? We get to do this all again? Gee, I can't wait to be a flowing skull all over again. We... like him. What a tard. Spoken just like someone who hasn't died before, huh?
Yeah.
You'll be able to start anew without the burden of memory or your past life. Your soul goal, if you will. He smiles at his own humor. Is to merge with the new plane that you are on, becoming one with the ideals and the very substance of the plane itself. You shall be one of the inhabitants, the petitioners on this plane, or ideally, one of the building blocks upon which the plane is built. It is the goal of all petitioners. To accomplish this goal, you, he claps his hands together for emphasis, must hold to your ideals! Dude, this guy was doing the whole Twitter thing before they started it. The whole, cancel this Hollywood star. Holy shit. God damn it. All you need to do is just replace the clap with an emoji and it's just like Twitter. Morte whispers, oh, this is one big steaming load. Your ideals, good or evil, law or chaos, or somewhere in between, are you, as you approach the alignment of the plane, your journey will end as you become part of the plane itself. 'Tis a glorious existence, my Sigillians. And this is what awaits you after death, my audience. Have a care as to how you live your life, but know that it is not oblivion that awaits you after this life. Morte says aloud, what a wash! The speaker's head turns to face Morte, frowning slightly. He leans out, trying to see who spoke. A question? A question from one of the living, perhaps? Morte ducks below the lecturer's field of view, then turns to you and whispers, go ahead, Chief. Tell the dark of it. Yeah, I have a question. He indicates for you to continue. Can a petitioner die? You look slightly uncomfortable at this. Well, yes.
Hey, bada bing, baby.
Did you kill the man who cursed you with hiccups? I did, but it didn't help. I said, please, cure me of these hiccups. I'm sorry for what I did just by talking to you. We'll meet him again and we'll do it again. But not before I save. What happens when they die? He looks a little more uncomfortable. Well, you merge with the plane. What if the petitioner dies on a plane other than their home plane? He looks very uncomfortable. Yeah, well, then that is the end of life. There, but no petitioner wants to leave their own plane, Phil, friend. He looks around, realizing he is in a trap. To do so would be oblivion should they die, really. I had other questions. What determines which plane you go to when you die? Your alignment, of course. Good people are destined for the upper planes, and bad people are cast into the lower planes. He rolls his eyes, clasping his hands to his heart dramatically. May the powers have mercy on their souls. Where do neutral people go? Raises an eyebrow. An excellent question. Excellent. Herons. He runs to the audience, raising a finger. The answer is this. A spirit that has lived a life of complete neutrality with no leaning toward good or evil becomes a petitioner on the Outlands, the lands that encircle Sigil. They are destined for no plane except the land that lies right outside our sky and of which the Spire is a part of. Is a part. And another question. What if someone can't die? He laughs. Nonsense. Everyone dies, friend. Even gods die. I can't die. Oh, truly, look, everyone. A rare treat. One of the great immortals graced us with his presence. Greetings, immortal. Immortal. The audience laughs. I can probe it. Oh, no. There's more laughter from the audience. What sport? Take heed, my audience. I think we shall have a rare display of my lecture today. Come up here, O mortal, and we shall see who is right and who is dead. Alright. The speaker turns white at this, taking a step back. By the powers! I think it's only fair that you prove your point now. The audience watches in morbid fascination. Well, now. Go on, die. Here, now, prove your words to be true. Embrace your life as a petitioner. Kill yourself. Do it. He goes. He offers weakly. I must confess that I'm not quite ready to depart this life just yet. I'm gonna make a motion. I'm gonna fake him out. Did you kill the man? If you killed him, then you have them forever. No! But he wouldn't help me. He just said... That's it. Make a motion to kill him, stopping just short of his neck. The speaker flinches, clasping his eyes shut and screeching. You hear a drizzling sound as he soils himself. So this great new life of the Outer Planes may not be all it's supposed to be? Speaker is aware of his hypocrisy, but is afraid of the alternative. Perhaps not. He glances quickly at the audience. Well, certainly not now, as I thought. I had another question. Never mind. There are no more questions. You ready to leave? He looks eager to wrap things up. Then I shall end this session. I shall continue lecture here at the hall, so tell all your friends. Someone in the audience shouts, "Sure, so they can come see you mess your tunic again." The room fills with laughter. Yeah, atheist one, god people zero. Where's your god now, atheist, huh? I mean, where's your god now, Christian people? I'll make you piss yourself. Make you piss yourself so hard you question your faith, idiot. What a good time. What a good sport. You know, wow, what a true sport. So that's Merryman. He's not the man we need. We need another man called... Problem is, I don't know where he is now. He was running around these halls, and I ran into him, and I'm like, "Oh, what's up, dude?" And he said, "Bleh." Three planes aligned. No thanks. That's another lecture. That's the warrior training room. This is this room. And then we got this room. So what are we supposed to be doing? Lothar suggested that the next stage in my journey might be to journey to the Civic Fest Hall, where someone may be able to tell me more about the hag Ravel Puzzlewell, whom Lothar believes stole my immortality from me.
Yeah,
you have to convince him to uncurse. It's your lifestyle now. Gotcha. It's a shame I can't meet him again, because he's quite the curious little boy. He goes, ha ha, look at me, I eat my card that says my name. How can you help me? Could I buy something for the Sensate Vaults? You must be a member of the Society of Sensation. Oh, but I am a Sensate, really. A true priest king of Ur can see the lies dripping from one's tongue. It is unwise to lie to us, traveler. I was jesting, not lying. I had another question. You would be pleased to answer your question. There was someone I was looking for. Just kidding, idiot. Sensei, troll me. You want to kill me again for another big old coin? She shakes. There are no other things. Yeah. What a fucking bitch. Oh yeah, we have to find this guy's head. He has no head. So they said to find someone here who could help me find more info, but I think I'll just leave. Bye. Cursed with hiccups. You can't do this to me, you motherfucker. You've killed me. Motherfucker. Clerk's Ward Citizen. We should go back to the brothel. Brothel had quite the treat of people. What's in here? Welcome to Pestilkin. Hello. You see a wall-eyed fellow whose skin seems to writhe and ripple across his entire body. He is smacking his chapped lips with a blotched tongue. As you watch, his right eye moves independently of the left, focusing on you. A second later, the left one flicks to look your way, then reverts to its original position. The right eye blinks. A strange gurgling comes from his throat. Stop! It's fucking gross! Allie can see the succubus now. Yeah, but he doesn't care. He only cares about 3D and yelling at me. The man gives a lopsided grin and points at himself with his right thumb.
I'm called the alchemist.
He points at himself again, this time with his left index finger.
The name's Kim. Need something?
Are you alright? His throat convulses for a moment, then relaxes. A large green glowing pustule suddenly bursts from the side of his neck.
Something you need, insert.
His throat clenches again, and a wave of quivering flesh swallows the blistering green pustule back beneath the skin of his throat. He coughs violently for a moment, then he seems to relax. I fucking hate this game. I love it. Suck your butt.
I'll show you if you say so, but he's not gonna fucking look at it. He's gonna go, ooh.
The left eye rolls upward in exasperation. The right eye looks askance.
Too much to drink.
Too much of what, though?
Potions I drink. Too many potions.
His mouth slides down beneath his chin. His left nostril forms another one.
The most I ever drink, that's for certain, of polymorphin. They were in limbo.
Anything I could do to help? The man's eyes turn inwards to look at each other, then back to you.
The note.
Shudder. He shudders. The mouth below his chin moves up to envelop the one his nostril formed. This
sort of thing happens quite often. We can't seem to help but sample the stock. If you find a way to help the two of us, we'll be grateful, sir.
Two of them? I had another question. Half of his mouth curls downwards into a frown. He shakes his head.
Working in the stockroom all day.
He shudders violently. Suddenly, a third eye pops open over the bridge of his nose. Stop! Over the bridge of his nose. The left one shifts sideways as the new eye takes its place.
I speak only for the store, sir.
That said, the skin of his face seems to eat the new eye. And the left one returns to its old location.
He's just a fucking puddle! There's a puddle of flesh!
Oh, he can't yell at you.
I yell at you, that's my thing!
Yeah? Well, don't you remember when one of the viewers that I had before would come in and say, yo, you're a black devil! Alvin, instead of coming in and explaining a 3D object and or saying that you woke up, you now have to come in and say, yo, each time. You're the new zombie. You're the new zombie. Trade badges with him, quick. Steal his identity. Steal social security that you can't use because you're in Canada. Then. I want to purchase something. We got blood, 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 charms, blood, blood. Great. Thanks. Bye.
All right.
It's a sensei. Please, sir, I have things to do. I'd appreciate you leaving me be if you'd be so kind.
Clerk Ward Citizen. Please, sir, I have things to do. Ugh. Ew. He's moaning. Hate it. Barkeeper. No, I don't want barkeep. Cafe patron Alwyn. Hey, that's the lady. This tall, slender woman occasionally looks up from her cup of wine to scan the surrounding patrons and passerby. Her facial features are elegantly exotic and her eyes a brilliant golden color catch the light, sparkling as she looks about.
Hello, little one.
She regards you carefully for a moment before replying. She speaks slowly and carefully, avoiding direct eye contact with you. I, Alwyn, return your greetings. Alwyn, your friend Nimble is looking for you.
Updated my journal.
She begins to smile, but then covers her mouth with her hand and looks down at her drink. I, Alwyn, am most pleased to hear of Nimble. Might I, Alwyn, persuade you to tell her of this place? Yes, I'll do that for you.
Updated my journal.
He looks at you directly, and for just the briefest of moments before her... Before she casts her eyes back down to her drink, your senses are awash with a warm, comfortable feeling, pure happiness. I, Alwyn, thank you. It's my pleasure. May I ask you about her, though? Alwyn nods slowly. The way she speaks and what her words do, how? I, Alwyn, can only see that we come from another place, another world. We are not like the people here. Whose words, thoughts, very feelings even affect nothing directly. Go on. I, Alwyn, take great care so as to not affect those around me too greatly. Nimble, she is new here and cannot do so. It is something she must learn should she choose to remain here much longer.
But why?
There are many reasons I, Alwyn, feel it is not right to impose reality upon those without the ability to impose their own reality upon me, Alwyn.
Is there anything you cannot do by simply speaking of it?
He frowns. A strange, unpleasant feeling rises in the pit of your stomach. Please, I, Alwyn, would speak of it no more.
Alright. So I gotta go tell the other lady.
I'll be right back. I need water. But before I do, can I just come in and say that your dick smells like the inside of your dead whale carcass? No. I'll ban him before I switch badges. I'll fight him to unviewership.
You gotta ban each other.
I'll give Halivan a sword as well, and then that way you both can fight. Sword be sword.
Yeah. I'll be right back real quick. 1 second.
I also have to take a call, so 1 second.
death consumes me forever. How many viewers did I lose, huh? 10? 12? Go ahead, tell me. Tell me the statistics so that way I can become slightly disappointed with myself. Distant coughing. I agree. Coronavirus is distant from me. I'm glad there's maybe a vaccine. One hit. Was it you? Did I lose you? Are you gone? The beautiful, seductively attired prostitute is a far cry from those you saw in the hive. She smells of expensive perfumes, and the lines of her face are subtly accentuated with the lightly painted lines of soft, warm colors. She smiles as you approach her, and curtsies, gracefully. Greetings, good sir. Seeking to quench a lust, Mistress Grace's brothel cannot satisfy, I hope? Yes, I am. It is but 500 coins, good sir, and I shall pleasure you in 1,000 ways. She tilts her head coyly, gives you a mischievous smile. Will you come with me, then? 500, that's quite a bit. She smiles. Oh, I assure you, good sir. She leans in closer to whisper warmly in your ear. 'Tis worth every last copper. I doubt it. Farewell. Stay there, chief. What do you say? How about spotting old Morte a bit of cheek? It's been a while. It's been more than a while, you know. Oh, I don't know. Should I let Morte get boned? Should I let Morte get boned? It was Mudbrain. Shit.
Should've known.
God damn it! You gotta really leave Morte. Halivan, if you're still alive, say arrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrrr
tone of disappointment. He'll get tooth herpes. I'm undead. Great. Look. Time to show you the succubus. I hope you like pixels. There she is.
How may I help you?
There she is. Fall from Grace turns as you approach and smiles slightly. How may I help you?
I have some questions.
Yes? If I may ask, Lady Grace, the wings on your back, you are not a human, I take it?
She's one of them planes! One of the succubi! She is! She'll take you! Measure, then she'll make your soul to the lower plane, she will! Your companion is correct. I'm a lesser Tanari. More specifically, a succubus.
She gives a soft sigh.
I'm afraid we're a little too common in the lower planes, and elsewhere for our own good. Most of my race spend their time seducing mortals with various pleasures of the flesh.
I see, got some other questions.
Succubit. Ooh, what a cutie!
I know, if only there was a render of her. In game. She's a smarty sucky. No sex, only conversation. It's true, Halivan. This succubus runs this brothel. And I was excited when I first came in and it said brothel, right? But it's a different brothel. People here, the women here, they intellectually debate you. They will smart talk with you instead of having the physical sex. They will fuck your mind instead. Can you tell me what you know of Ravel again?
He was said to be one of the hags.
Anyone else? Someone in the pest hall may know more of her. I see. Thank you. Goodbye. Probably just make me come even harder. No, but like, it's intellectual. Intellectual speak, you know what I mean? Like, they talk hard. We gotta go tell this girl. Hey, Juliet. Juliet looks at you, hopefully.
Well, anything yet?
Yes, in fact, he was heartbroken and has decided to leave you to me.
Updated my journal.
You're not going to fight for me then? No, he won't. Juliet looks shocked and seconds later begins to whimper and cry pitifully. That's what you get. It's a shame it turned out this way. I'll come back another time, Juliet. Farewell.
You know, I've learned some new tricks. Hi?
Anna, why would you level up during this heartbreaking moment? Big brain make me come. Yeah, hot succubus debating with me and showing me her big brain would make me come in my pants. Allie has a hair trigger cum gun. Stop! That's fucking gross. Jesus. You know, you should be a writer for this game. Wait, fall from grace! Woo! There she is! 3D render! Fall from grace is a succubus, one of the Tanari, a creature literally formed of raw chaos and evil. Her body and mind, the perfect template to tempt a man of any species and any age. She is the proprietress of the brothel of slating intellectual lust. Yeah. Oh, splurt. Stop. It's disgusting. She's looking cool. I like her flesh wings. They're very nice. So she might be an actual person that we can that we can have in our party, maybe. If she's in that, then yeah, maybe. What do we have here? I don't care. Bashed it. Whoa, that's a lot of money. Handkerchief. Nanny Nine Eyes. This petite, attractive young woman is smiling blissfully and humming to herself. Her wide, pale blue eyes seem to constantly drink in her surroundings as she looks about. Hello. The smiling young woman curtsies gracefully and looks up at you, smiling.
Well met, good sir. I'm Ninny. And how are you this fine day?
She suddenly notices your scars and places a gloved hand over her mouth.
Oh my, you're hurt.
She blinks.
All over.
Morte spins around you, mocking the girl's obviousness. I was above, Chief. She's right. I never noticed before. You're covered in scars.
Pay no mind. Only slightly. I'll be all right.
She nods quietly, lowering her hand. I had some questions.
Huh?
She can't seem to tear her eyes from your scars.
Oh, how shameful of me. Don't mind my rude staring. I am named Ninny.
He makes a little curtsy.
And it is my great pleasure to welcome you to our brothel for the slating of intellectual lust.
She returns to staring at your body.
You have tattoos under those scars too. What's that one?
She points to one of your tattoos. That's what...
She looks fascinating. Oh shit, I'm dying. Looks fascinating. Look at the way the lines of ink, I think that's ink.
Squints at the tattoo, then reaches out to touch it.
Allow her to touch me.
I think that's ink.
She traces a finger around the edge of the tattoo.
Is it ink? And what a pattern. Look at the way the lines intersect here.
She touches the center of the tattoo.
That's simply amazing.
She purses her lips and frowns in disappointment.
I could make it out better if there weren't so many scars.
There's nothing to be done about the scars, they're permanent.
Oh, I'm sorry. Pox on me for even mentioning them.
She cringes.
But I have to know, are you absolutely sure you're alright? I'm looking at you and I can't help but believe that you're not in some pain.
I have amnesia, but that is all.
Amnesia? Nanny blinks, then brightens. Loss of memory! You are so lucky, she chimes perkily. Everything must be so new to you.
There is truth in that, but the newness is unwelcome. She blinks.
That sounds so sad.
Yeah, it is, but I had some questions.
Please ask, she smiles giddily.
What are you doing here?
I'm talking to you, silly.
She giggles and pokes you in the belly.
Just like I talk to all the patrons here. All the prostitutes do. That's what the brothel's about. Learning new ways to talk and share experiences and understand other people.
And other questions, Daddy. Do you know anything about Ravel Puzzle Well?
Updated my journal.
No, sorry. That's a great name, though, huh? I'll bet she's a really interesting person. Hey, you should ask Yavis about her. Yavis collects all kinds of stories.
Where the fuck is she? That's all I wish to know. Goodbye. She's looking cool.
Could be. Like, you're only missing one character and you still need a healer. She may bore the wounds away with a conversation.
I need to find out what she'd be like. We need love!
I need it. Need it. Echo. Ooh, she looks nice. I like her name too. It's very generic.
I like how everyone just fucking bashes it open. Hello. This striking young woman has skin the color of burnished copper, a translucent white dress held precariously by golden clasps is draped carefully over her shapely form. Hello. The woman nods and smiles briefly. The scent of her hair, sweetly perfumed, fills your nostrils. Had some questions. She nods. Who are you? Smiles and curtsies, but offers no response. Can you speak? She shakes her head and smiles sadly at you.
Updated my journal.
I love this shit already. Morte, come on. You're a boomer, Morte. Damn it. Would be. I need to know how to get that woman. Because I need to love her.
Can you write then, or pantomime? She pouts, shaking her head. May I ask why you can't communicate? She sighs and softly nods. Actually, let me ask you about something else. She nods. Anything about Ravel Puzzlewell? Her eyes flash and she smiles. She nods at you. What do you know of her?
Updated my journal.
She simply looks at you. May I ask why you can't communicate? I think maybe one of my abilities might help. Striking young woman, greetings again. Had some questions, she nods. Okay. That didn't work. Didn't matter. Who lies in this one? A sex woman or the succu lady? I need the succu lady. She needs to be mine. So that way I can have the cool magic. Maybe magic. We have a lot of gold and all that. Oh, that's not what I wanted. Put it all on Morte. A lot of good shit. You need to heal up. Do something. I don't care. Just fucking heal yourself. There you go. Everyone's healed. Everyone's Gucci. Perod's crunch.
I still don't know what I need to do with my arm, but
I have it. We should let the Lim Lim walk around a bit. There you go.
Lim Lim is on the spree. Talk to her more. I probably will. Then I'll say, wow, 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 Wubsy. Where'd my Lim Lim go? Oh, there it is. I'm gonna talk to everyone else first, though. This is the weird chamber. Okay, then. Another odd one with a woman standing in the dark. Wait, you see that up there? That looks like something. Squinting at the figure behind the partition, you can barely make out a shapely female form in the darkness. She turns to you, but you can see nothing of her face. Hello. Figure answers in a voice that is slow and deadly, like a steel dagger drawn across stone.
It's come to speak with Marissa, have you? Quite rude of you to enter a darkened room, storming behind my partition like so? Rude and foolhardy. And hear a faint whispering sound like a slight breeze or the hissing of serpents. Morpe whispers quietly, "Whoa, creepy shit." My apologies, my lady. I wasn't sure if someone was here. Someone gives a slight
But it would seem there is someone in this room, wouldn't it? Shall you be on your way, then?
Not just yet. I had some questions.
Ask.
Why do you remain behind the screen? Why is it so dark in here?
To prevent any unwanted and embarrassing casualties. Now, what is it that you want?
I want you to come into the light.
Nay, and the addition of please will not serve to persuade me. Now, what do you want? Surely, did you not come all this way to see me?
I do want to see what you look like.
You have no such want.
I do.
What do you look like? The darkness hides us both. Let's make it a game. I'm frightfully bored. Let me guess, are you human male?
Thanks, yeah.
Are you wounded in the throat?
I can't see, but I believe so, yes.
Describe yourself for me.
I'm very tall, muscular, and horribly scarred.
Indeed?
Pause this for a moment.
How were you so horribly scarred? Wait, never mind, I do not wish to know.
Describe yourself for me. Marissa describes herself as a shapely, pale-skinned, beautiful woman with a forked tongue, hair made up of writhing asps, and glowing eyes which you assume she must be keeping shut. Are you a fiend?
Updated my journal.
Marissa laughs lightly, the sound accompanied by a slight hissing.
No, hardly, though I've powers some might call fiendish. My glance turns
Yeah, she's a Medusa!
Living things to stone, for instance, from beings of flesh to statuary with the bat of an eyelash.
Could you turn, say, a Lim Lim into a statue?
Updated my journal.
I suppose I could, had you a Lim Lim, and were I inclined to do so. I might be so inclined, had I my crimson veil, but I do not know where it has gone. Have you seen it, perchance?
No. What's it for? Is it just a normal veil? Marissa sighs quietly.
Not quite. It aids me in communication. Face-to-face communication, that is.
What do you need to hide your face?
Enough with these asinine questions. How tiresomely annoying you are. Now, what do you want?
What are you doing here?
Give me the Lim Lim.
Pick the Lim Lim back up. Yo. More pointless questions. Lim Lim into statue?
Fuck! I need a crimson veil! I need to turn my Lim Lim into a statue! Please!
This conversation sounds like what I think online dating / random nudes sharing sounds like.
You tell me what you look like. No, you.
Well, I have a penis. Disconnect. 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 Right?
What can you tell me about the silent prostitute?
Updated my journal.
Yes, Echo. I knew another Echo once, though her name was written differently. I know nothing of this girl, though. Asked the lore of her. She made friends of an old lover of Echoes, I have heard.
And another question.
Well, puzzle well.
No, do you?
You hear an annoyed sigh from out of the darkness.
Go ask Yvis. She collects many tales and can probably tell you something of use.
Forget I asked anything. Bye.
Ignis, get out of there. Boy. What is this? The Dead Rising AI? Shit. Kasai Saris.
I will have to investigate that woman in just a moment.
God, please, people. Brothel, brothel. Female brothel patrons. Kinky. This alarmingly voluptuous woman has a thick mane of wavy, raven-colored hair, bluish skin, and a shimmering crimson eyes like rubies, which have fires lit behind them. Though she is not beautiful in the typical sense of the word, her features are exotic and not altogether unattractive. Hello. The woman's voice is deep and sensuous.
My greetings to you, sir.
Her burning eyes roam over you.
I'm Kasai Saris. So tell me, what might I do for you,
Anything, Morte cries.
Do anything you want to me.
Kasai laughs heartily, revealing canines long enough to be considered fangs. She shakes her head and smiles at Morte.
Truly though, please, what can I do for you?
What do you usually do for your patrons?
Talk, of course, usually about dreams, often those erotic in nature, but not always.
Kasai winks at you, smiling.
So, would you like to tell me yours? Don't be shy, I've heard everything. You know, nothing will shock or surprise me, and I so love to hear people's dreams. We can trade if you'd like to, but you must go first.
My dreams were recently revised when I saw you, my lady.
Were they now?
Kasai smiles, her gleaming red eyes looking over once more.
You look very savage, you know. Tell me, are you rough with your lovers in the act, I mean? Very physical?
Only if it pleases them. It depends on the mood I'm in, really. Kasai nods, smiling.
I thought you'd say as much. I'm quite rough myself. I like to be carried around, and I particularly enjoy biting. I've sharp teeth, though, so I have to take care. Sometimes I get carried away and draw a little blood, you know.
It's enough to make me weep. Where was this shit when I had a body?
Damn, Morte, please!
My dream is to get cock milked by a succubus for all of eternity. But, Halivan, if you eat ice cream every day, ice cream is no longer special to you.
Roaming the Outlands, most likely. But that was a rhetorical question, wasn't it?
He winks at Morte, then turns to you again. You have sharp teeth? Kasai nods.
I certainly do. Would you like to see?
Here. She opens her mouth slightly, running her violet tongue over her bottom teeth. Her canines are just long enough to be considered fangs. Bites from those would not go over well with me.
Oh, see? That's why it's so important to talk about such things, especially with one's lover. A couple's first time together could be such improved if they discussed the act beforehand. Besides, it's such fun to talk about.
Sai smiles widely at you, her eyes glinting like two red jewels. Guess I'd say it is. Sai nods, looking lost in thought for a moment.
Say, you never did tell me about your dreams, you know? Come on, let's have at them.
I don't have dreams, actually. Sai arches her eyebrows in surprise.
Truly? How sad. Even fiends and divas dream, you know? Are you certain you don't?
Quite certain, no dreams at all.
So peculiar. I'm at a loss at what to say.
I did have some questions. Sai blinks her crimson eyes at you, awaiting your question. What are you?
Sai shakes her head. What? Can't you tell?
She draws herself up, thrusting her ample bosom towards you.
A woman!
She raises an eyebrow.
I can see my answer doesn't please you. I'm plain touched, actually, like your friend here.
Kasai indicates Anna. That's all you need to know. Plain touched? What does that mean? What are you doing here?
Repeating your questions, it seems. She winks at you. Really, though, I'm a student of Mistress Grace's. All the prostitutes in the brothel are.
Student?
That's right. The brothel is actually a school for women who are thinking of becoming sensates. Mistress Grace teaches us the ways of language so that we can better identify with ourselves and those around us. It lets us experience the planes more fully, you know.
Okay. Well, can you tell me about the silent prostitute?
Yes, that's Echo. She's very sweet, but so quiet. I understand that she said something once which caused some great tragedy, and because of that, she'll never speak again.
Sai shrugs, smiling.
An interesting enough story, but I don't know if it's true. Try asking Delora. I've seen her talking to an ex-lover of Echo, back from a time when Echo was speaking.
Okay, I have another question. Trying to find Marissa's crimson veil. Do you know where it might be?
Updated my journal.
No, I haven't seen it since the last time she wore it out. But Ninny might have something, so try asking her. I'll admit, it's been a nice... Marissa won't leave her chamber without the veil. So we've all been spared her foul tongue, leaving us only Kamaxi to deal with.
Kasai smirks.
That Kamaxi is the worst of the two, though.
How so?
Marissa's haughty and mean, but Kamaxi. She's a bitter, spiteful monster of a woman with a venomous tongue and the demeanor of a bailer. I can't see why anyone would like to speak with her. I sincerely doubt her appearance makes up for that flaying, poisonous mouth of hers, but she receives patrons nonetheless.
Alright, I had other questions. You know about Ravel. Are you sure? You seem suddenly upset. Know nothing.
She narrows her red eyes at you. Of course I'm sure. Don't ask me of her again.
Farewell then. So there is a... Oh boy. It's a fucking goat lady. She's got goat legs. I can't wait to find out what she's like.
These hookers are bad. Like, they sell conversation but just give it away for free.
You're right. Well, apparently they're students, so apparently this is just like, you know, it's whatever.
Oh, man. The wild-looking tiefling girl meets your gaze with an angry scowl. Her tattooed body is particularly naked, covered by only a narrow leather thong, a black cloth brassier, and armored shoulder pads that appear to serve more as decoration rather than actual protection. Her spiked hair, as well as the thin fur that covers her goat-like legs, is brassy white. And... numerous silver rings dangle from her ears, nostrils, lips, and brow. She wears a leather collar around her throat with the inscription Kimazaxi. I'ma just call her Kim, okay? Kim Addertongue.
Hello. Kim bares her teeth at you. And what? And just what are you looking at, you banged up sod? My friend thought you were attractive, but whoa! Was he ever horribly mistaken? She sneers at Morte, then looks below him, where a body would normally be. Sharp tongue for a stimless debtor. Snuff you two. Let them keep at it. Like I'd let mine anywhere near if I had one. What? Did you hear the word brothel and think you could make some jink here, you flea-bitten gutter hole? Ha! Can't believe they even let you in the door. With what with those ticks hopping off your shaggy legs? Let them keep at it. Ticks! The only annoying insect here is you. She suddenly turns to you. Hey, you here to talk to me or what? Or what? What else can I do with you? What did you have in mind, you sodding jawbox? Go ahead, give me a reason to say no to you. You usually do for patrons. I'm a practitioner of abuse. What's that mean? I'll show you. Her hand lashes out to slap your face, but you manage to barely dodge the blow. Kim pouts visibly, then scowls. Oh well. So you can teach Morte here to be more abusive? She raises her eyebrows. Now that's an unusual request. I don't know. Seems pretty foul-mouthed already. Seems pretty foul-mouthed. Kim, bladder dung. You scruffy goat-gammed harlot. Shit. Hoof lady. Murder her for her lucky hoofs. But she's funny. She make fun of the boy. You wish you had legs like mine, you pitiful wretch of bone box. I can walk, run, dance. What do you do? Bob around wishing you had a pair. Goats or otherwise. The two of them lay into one another, exchanging barbed, blistering insults and clashing with razor-edged tongues. Wait for it to end. At last, the two stop their bickering, and eerie silence settles over them as they eye one another, hatefully. Finally, the tiefling makes a grudging admission to Morte. You're not bad, really, not bad at all. Better than you, perhaps? Morte waggles his eyebrows at her. Eh, eh? Kim narrows her eyes at Morte. Don't push it, skull.
New taunts, all right.
I won't. Deeply. I will admit, I might have learned a thing or two, though. Good thinking, chief. Sure thing, Morte. Kim turns to you. So was that all you wanted? I'm not spending any more time near you than I have to. I had some questions. The tiefling rolls her eyes. And what makes you think I care? Why don't you lick my backside? My tongue's not wide enough, and I don't like hair in my mouth. Well, you seem to like the taste of awful offal in your mouth, you dung-breathed cretin. Only because it's like kissing you, you mangy stink. Pot, dude, what is... Oh, so many insults. Kiss me? She makes a retching sound. I'd rather kiss a bloody mass of phlegm than lay my lips on you. No thanks. Don't thank me. Thank the power someone actually wants to kiss you. Kim looks at a loss for something to say. For an instant, a smile threatens to crack the grimacing mask of her face. Then she becomes a more of a basilisk than ever. All right, what do you want of me? Christian's answered. She likes it. She likes being called fucking names. Well, he wants you to her booty like groceries. She wants it. Can you tell me about the silent prostitute? What, that echo chit? Don't know anything about her. Don't talk to the girl. I mean, why? Not like she can talk back. Ask Frigid Delora about her. I think I saw her playing Go with an old crush of Echo's back from when she could talk. Another question. I'm trying to find Marissa Crimson's Veil. Do you know where it might be? She smirks. Up your arse? Perhaps? I don't know. Kim smooths back her hair, which instantly springs back up to a spiky mess. Another question.
What are you doing here? Not you, that's for certain. He smirks at you. I'm contemplating the best way to tell you pike off next. Do you know anything about Ravel Puzzlewell? What would I know about her? I look like a scholar or something to you? That's someone more learned. Or this. She'll probably have at least one story about her in that pile of tales she cares about in her bone box. Oh, and squat on a halberd while you're at it. Dude, what the fuck? That's pretty fucked up. But I'm glad. That was a fun time. This the tail chaser. Okay. Container is locked. Break it! Yeah, I'm breaking it open. Love letter. This letter is a passionate, steamy, and rather graphic love letter to whom it's from, however, are quite fake. Take it, yoink. Haha. Got it. We'll talk to this. Eat. Oh, what? That's a bad stroke. I think you're having multiple strokes. Fucking dying on the ground. This fetching young woman has a faraway look in her soft sea green eyes. Hello.
Greetings, I am Vest, Tail Chaser.
What a coincidence, I too chase tails. Vest continues unperturbed.
Have you come to trade tails?
Like to trade tails? Vest nods.
I would like that very much.
Tell her the story of you waking up in the mortuary. Lingering sighs. Vess leans forward as you tell the tale of the alley, giving birth. She seems to devour your every word. As you finish, she smiles at you.
I shall remember this tale, and now I have one for you. Before I begin, I must ask, do you know what a Modron is?
One of those box, right? Yeah.
And I shall tell you the tale of the clock and the quadrone.
Go on.
Once upon a time, there existed a Modron. It was newly created, its logic fresh and untested, and it had come to Sigil, following the command of its Modron superiors.
Go on.
It knew nothing but commands and dictates of obedience and passing along the orders of its superiors. For you see, Modrons are only aware of the command of their immediate superiors. They have no grasp of a higher authority until this one.
Yes.
One day, it came upon a small shop within which there was a small clock that could no longer tell time. It was cracked along the edges, the wheels of its hands broken. The Modron immediately set itself to work at getting the parts to fix the broken clock.
Yeah?
I made a new wooden house for the clock's parts, replaced the bent springs, carefully filed and oiled the clockwork machinery, carved new hands from the sparse metal available to it. The newly repaired clock's precise ticking reminded it of the great gears of Mechanus, and it comforted it as much as any new thing may comfort a Modron.
Yes. One second, I gotta get a drink. Death time, fun time now. More like trying time.
And what that Modron never came to understand was that it truly loved this clock and it had worked on, and for reasons it could not explain, elected to remain in Sigil and be with the clock for the rest of its years.
I have another tale to share with you. Waking up in the mortuary. Vess leans forward as you tell the tale of your awakening. Your awakening. The Dustman's mortuary. She seems to devour your every word. As you finish, she smiles at you.
I shall remember this tale. I, too, will tell of the Dustman, chapters of dust.
Yes.
There are chapters in the Dead Book, the massive tome which the Dustman keep that records the passing of all that lives into the internal boundary. In this book, there are chapters that are not but dust. It is believed that the names therein are lost souls who cannot die, but must suffer life eternally until history itself dies and grants them release. Ooh. I had a question for you, Bess. That's not squirrely. Hey, we trade tales. Ask one of my companions. Bess awaits your story patiently. Morte, do you have a story to trade? Me? Why do I have to tell a story? Get it then. Just tell a story, Morte. Fine, fine. An elderly man was sitting alone on a dark path, right? He wasn't certain of which direction to go. He'd forgotten both where he was traveling to and who he was. He sat down for a moment to rest his weary legs. He suddenly looked up to see an elderly woman before him. She grinned toothlessly and with a cackle spoke, "Now your third wish. What will it be?" Ooh, that sounds pretty nice. Go on. Third wish? The man was baffled. How can it be a third wish if I haven't had the first and second wish? Go on. You've had two wishes already, the hag said. But your second wish was for me to return everything to the way it was before you had made your first wish. That's why you remember nothing. Because everything is the way it was before you made any wishes. She cackled at the poor Burke. So, is that you have one wish left? Alright, said the man. I don't believe this, but there's no harm in wishing. I wish to know who I am. Funny, said the old woman as she granted his wish and disappeared forever. That was your first wish. Damn, that was like a creepypasta. Bess smiles. An interesting tale, Morte, and now I've for one for you and your companion, a fiend's game. A fiend sometime wandered the wilderness for of a certain prime world of... Wait. Prime time never happens. It's all because of you! And Devin! And East! And Halloran! And Levo! And everybody! Everybody. A fiend sometimes wandered the wilderness of a certain prime world in the guise of a friendly old man. One day he came upon some hunters in the wood. What are you doing? The fiend asked. The hunters told him the fiend nodded. I've never been on a hunt before. The hunters invited the old man to come along. The group eventually came upon a glade where several deer were grazing. The hunters carried crossbows but did not fire, and the fiend asked them why. They are unarmed, the hunters chuckled, patting their crossbows. We hunt nothing that does not have the ability to defend itself. After all, where is the sport in that? The fiend nodded at this and promptly gated in three of his fellows. The hunters led them on a merry chase, but eventually they were caught and eaten. What the fuck? Another. Ask one of my companions, Anna. I'm no good at telling such things, I'm not. She frowns and waves her hands as if trying to shoo away the idea. Do not be asking me for such nonsense now. Miss smiles at Anna. I would very much like to hear your story. Please share your story, Anna. Come on already, Tiefling. Fiendling. You already have one tail you won't part with. Anna looks uncomfortable, her tail lashing slowly back and forth. Well, I know one story. She suddenly becomes angry, glaring at Vess. But yeah, might not like it. You won't. So don't be blaming me for you choking it out of me.
Go ahead, Anna.
Anna scowls, then finally relents with an exasperated sigh. I heard a story when I was a wee lass. This Burke's walking home real late near Anthony Peak and passes an old toothless crone in a dark and otherwise empty street. Where you going? She asks him. See? That's why I needed the throat rest yesterday.
I liked Morte's story. I did too. It was really nice. It was interesting. Come on, Anna.
Home to me wife and Kip, he says. Near the slats? She asks him. Sure enough, he says. So she asks him a favor. Take a box she's got to Deader's Pit and give it to a woman there. Now this perk's a real sap. Too nice to say no despite the fact he's sure something's not quite right about this old crone. Agrees. But what's the woman's name? He asked. Where does she live? Where should I look for her if she's not by Deader's Pit? The woman hands him the box. A wooden thing wrapped in colored cloth. And tells him to just go on and she'll be fine. She'll be there. Finally, she warns him. Whatever you do, does, do not open the box. So he takes it home with him. Hides it in the rafters, thinking he'll bring it by the Deader's Pit when it's light out. His wife, though, seeing him hiding the box, gets right jealous, thinking it's a gift for a lover or something. Opens it up as soon as he's not looking. Well, turns out the box was full of gouged out eyes and severed male members with the hair still on them. Screams brought the Burke running. Remember that the crone said got what the crone said, got right scared and wrapped the box back up. Went out straight away to Deader's Pit. Sure enough, there was another old hag waiting there for him. He answered the box and says to him, this box has been opened and looked into it. The poor Burke tries to deny it, but she gets hit this dreadful look on her face. You've done something horrible. She tells him, then disappears. That done, he hurries back to his kip. He's feeling ill when he gets back and takes to the bed. His wife bitterly regretted opening the box and all, but it was too late. The next day, he died of a rotten disease. The first things to go was his eyes and stim. Anna nods grimly at her, her tale complete. That was a stupid one. Beth smiles. That was a wonderful tale, Anna. You should never hesitate to share it. I have one for you and your companion. The Parched Land.
Oh my god, I love experience, but this is too much!
Once a large village was struck by a terrible drought, a farmer journeyed to the Worshipping Stone and again implored it as to the cause of the drought. He asked the stone why it did nothing when the fields were parched and dying. Why the animals and the people suffered while the stone did not a thing. Have we not given enough offerings? The farmer asked, begging almost upon his hands and knees. The stone did not respond. It merely sat and cast its shadow. Vest nods. I would like that very much, yes. Oh, I've another. Wait, what about the other? Wait, what? Dakon nods solemnly. I shall impart the tale of Achille drowning. Dakon tells the story of Achille, a foolish Gazari of myth who had become lost in the chaos of Limbo. Normally, a single Gazari may use their focus and mental discipline to form the chaos around them into a small, habitable environment. Achille, however, asked so many useless and unfocused questions in her quest to return home that her isle of matter dissolved around her and she drowned. Vess smiles. Fascinating, Dakon. Let me share with you your companion another version of that tale that I've heard. Dakon looks attentive and perhaps a little surprised. Vess goes on to tell a different version of Dakon's tale, in which Achille was driven from the Githzari city of Shraktlor for her constant useless prattling. One day, she encountered a Slotty on his way to the Spawning Stone. He hastily erected a wall of chaos, matter, which even the ravenous Slotty found difficult to break down. Hungrily, it waited and spoke to her through the wall. She asked it questions. As she became more absorbed in her pointless queries, the Slotty's answers, her own wall decayed, collapsed upon her, and thus she drowned in the matter of Limbo. I have another tale.
asked one of the companions. Actually, let me ask you a question. So we're done with the tales. We're done. Smartman is boring. Cut him for his mistake. He didn't even get to tell his story. It's not like, oh yeah, he just told a story of this one thing. Okay. What can you tell me of the silent prostitute? Echo? Best Round's thinking. I once heard a tale of a girl who knew the word that, if spoken, would undo the multiverse. Perhaps this is Echo. Ask Delora, though. I understand that she sometimes meets with one who knew Echo before she stopped speaking. Another question. Trying to find Marissa's Crimson Veil, do you know where it might be? Shakes her head. But Marissa's is an interesting tale. Would you like to hear it? Sure. Guess we're not done with the tales. Once upon a time, in a world of heroes and a time of petty, childish gods, there were three sisters, cursed with a hideous appearance. They were considered demons by the people of the land and forever shunned. One missed her sisters terribly, yet felt that the world with its shame behind, but exchanged the pettiness of a pantheon for the prettiness of self. So that might be her. Okay. Ravel Puzzlewell. The tale of Ravel Puzzlewell, frightener of children, begins and ends with a question. What can change the nature of a man? Many were the times she posed this riddle to those who approached her. Those who sought to glean from her the strange magics that she alone seemed to possess. All attempted to answer her query, but to no avail. And they found the price of their wrong answer. It to be some horrible fate, always more terrible than the last victims. To recount their various torments would be to speak things that nightmares are woven from. The tale strikes me in this way. Ravel herself knew not the answer to this question, but she lusted for such an answer. Only the why of the matter remained in question. Why did the nature of a man matter to one of the Grey Sisters, especially to one of such power as Ravel? It is said that she put the question to the Lady of Pain, not directly, but shouted it to Sigil itself, daring for the lady to answer. When no reply was forthcoming, she wove terrible magics that threatened to open the cage and let the fury of the planes roll in like a wave. She received no answer other than banishment. To this day, no one knows the answer to Ravel's question, and now there is no one to petition, for Ravel herself is gone, lost to the planes.
Updated my journal.
Wait, there is more. Though my tale ends with Ravel's demise, there are some that claim the hag still lives. There is a silent prostitute here who once talked of such things. She speaks no longer. If she would speak to you, she might tell you more of Ravel. What else? Okay, that's it. God, that feels like I'm standing there forever. You, I want you in my team. Come on! I have some other questions I want to ask you. I came here looking for help. Perhaps you can help me. I lost my memories. Please, what I remember woke up on a slab. Never mind. I think you can ask questions. Can you tell me about sensates? Would you like to join me on my travels? Anna stiffens, then starts muttering under her breath. Who's to say she'll be coming with us? I don't know. We don't need the likes of her, so we don't. Plus, we don't. Bar that, fiendling. Morte clicks his teeth together. I'm all for the succubus coming with us. The powers know you're about as fun as passing a cow trap through your bowels. It best latch your bone box, skull. I'll rattle you so hard they'll be picking your teeth off the spire. Travel with you? Fall from Grace smiles slightly. She seems to be ignoring your companions. That's rather forward of you. Hmm. I'd rather be honest with my intentions. You seem extremely pleasant and well-versed in the ways of the plains. A companion with that kind of knowledge would be welcome.
Wait just a minute. I'm the one well-versed in the plains. That's my job, Chief.
Having two people knowledgeable about the plains in our bad band, that seems pretty smart to me. Besides, I said pleasant, too, Morte.
Pleasant on the eyes, maybe. Looks to me like all some shit has to do is show a little skin. You'll sign it right up.
Morte falls silent.
Not that I mind that, really. I just thought I'd mention it.
Noted, Morte. Look, Lady Grace, excuse me if I'm being too forward, but would you care to travel with us?
I appreciate your candor. I shall counter with some of my own. Why should I travel with you?
Lady Grace, I intend to travel to places perhaps no one else has ever been to or could reach. Would that interest you?
That would indeed. She cups her chin in her hands and thinks for a moment. Yet...
You mean you wouldn't be interested in traveling with an immortal amnesiac who is searching the plains for himself?
Oh, I would be extremely interested. She smiles slightly. Such a suggestion is intriguing. Make no mistake about that.
Then would you like to travel with me?
If you wish me to, then there is something you must do for me. There are 10 students in this establishment. I would like you to speak to all of them, then return to me with your thoughts. Then we shall see if we shall travel together or not.
Updated. We'll speak to all of them.
I gotta go speak to them all. It's all me. I gotta save now.
This how it might serve me, Delora. Actually, I had some questions, Delora. Delora casts her eyes to the floor with a sound that might be a sad sigh. I'm willing to serve you as a patron, but I have no wish to answer other questions at this time. My apologies, but I fear you shall simply have to bear with that for the time being. What's wrong? Anything I can help you with? She looks up from the floor into your eyes. Once more, you're struck by the pale smoothness of skin, the cold depths of her silvery eyes. No, I fear not. My troubles are a matter of heart. In time, I think all things shall be resolved. Are you certain there's nothing I could do? Certain? Delora pauses as if thinking. No, I am not. My first love, Merriman. Merriman's in the fucking infesto! Possesses still the keys to my heart. As he has them, I shan't be free to love another. This is the cause of my melancholy. I'll find this Merriman and speak to him on your behalf.
Updated my journal.
Delora nods, the slightest hint of a smile appearing on her lips. She bows her head.
Were you to find and speak with Merriman, I would be most grateful. He is a member of the Society of Sensation, so you may wish to ask him for the civic at the Fest Hall.
Fest Hall, baby, tonight. It's also close to the 2 hour. That's what I meant by it's time for me to end the stream. Stream, end. So we're going to go to the Merryman. We're going to say, and then we're going to end the stream, and that'll be that, and that'll be that, and that'll be that.
All right.
He's all the way over here. Input stream.
There he is, Jumbo murder scene.
Wait, before you go, you need to see Jumbo. Jumbo's a whack. Watch. The short, balding man's orange tunic and rather sizable gut give him the look of a walking pumpkin. He is absent-mindedly patting his large paunch with a slow rhythm, as if it were a drum. The man's odd, crooked smile and a strange gleam in his eyes make him look a bit mad. Hello. The man gives an exaggerated, flourishing bow and presents a small card which reads only Jumble Murder Sense. Zyzatec Sorcerer and Zytredonair. He then snatches the card from your grasp and proceeds to eat it, grinning wildly all this while. Oh, you're talking to him. look at him. He's an evil bastard. Ordre whispers, somewhere in an asylum is one Barmy short. We'll save it for tomorrow. Because I don't want to get cursed yet. Maybe later. But, no. Anyways, I guess that'll be it for the night stream. You know, when I play this game, the night stream really passes. Like, you know, it feels like just seconds ago I began the stream, but it feels really nice, you know, as well. It makes me feel good. But, yeah, I suppose that'll be it. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in. It's been a grand time. And, yeah, maybe later tonight I'll be doing an art stream. If I'm feeling up to it. Last night I tried, but, it was not a good time. Anyways, I love y'all and toodles. Bye-bye.